Now today we got some cool stuff from Australia. We'll start the day off with a bright, shiny letter from our friend in Australia, Ian Smith, who we're going to see at Brodax very soon. Check these pictures out. Now, Ian Smith sent these pictures. Now, take a close look at these. It's from Australia. Now, this is a really nicely detailed model, of course, of our favorite plane, the Spitfire. Now, look at it real close. This is a really nice model. Now, it's obviously powered by a diesel, and I've got some information to read off of, just hit the high notes of Ian's long letter. It's powered by a 15 diesel. Made in 1950. It's a kit, all print wood, stick and tissue construction. Wingspan is 28 inches. Flaps are used to make it stunt. Which it does, but only just. That's pretty cool. Anyway, look how nice this little model is. I'm always impressed by the unique things in life, and that certainly is one of them. Now, I could picture, you know, this model. It's got the little blisters, the landing gear almost scale, the little cannons. That is, and the roundels, of course. Ian, that is really, really cool stuff. Now he's sharing with us a newsletter from the, I'm sure it's from Australia, Kingali Model Flying Club, Sydney, Australia. Anyway, Karen and I were just watching a show about Sydney, Australia, and obviously one of the things we wanted to do, of course, she's had a few health issues this year, as I have, and as our daughter has. But look at the nice newsletter they do here. Look, playing the bagpipes. Now, there's only one problem with this newsletter. See, this must be something from Australia. They only print on one side. But they had some cool stuff in here, and obviously I enjoy reading it. The Cardinal Stunt Event. Oh, look, he must think I don't know how to read English. Look, there's an arrow. Does he think I'm not going to read that, the Cardinal Stunt Event? Anyway, hey, we really enjoy this. And, of course, there's some nice pictures from Australia. I shouldn't be skipping over these. There's some nice stuff going on there. Now, the thing is, if and when Karen and I ever get to fulfill our dream of going to Australia, we're gonna expect the ultimate in hospitality from Ian. Because he's watched enough, he's watched enough Windy DVDs that he knows there better be Australian pizza, and it better not be like no pepperoni and pepperoni only. There better be other cool stuff. Look at all these, this is going to be a nice little article. I'm looking forward to reading this tonight. All these little 049s. Oh my God, great little stuff. Ian, what you ought to do, you know, you got all this cool information. This is stuff that could go in Control Line World. You ought to be a major contributor to Control Line World. Look at this. A lot of cool stuff. Anyway, it just fulfills my, and there's some stuff here on making models, little tips, but putting the dihedral, the wing sweep and biplanes. But here's the thing. There's a wide world of stuff, and obviously, there's a lot of it going on in Australia, and to tell you the truth, this little Spitfire, I'm kind of liking having him. Definitely will have a picture of him hanging in my shop in a place of honor. Now, Ramo Bark, in the next couple of weeks, he's going to make me some pictures of the, and Rich Walbridge said he'd make me some of the silver Spitfire. When we get those, we're going to try to frame a few of them up, put them in the shop, but we'll definitely hang on to these, Ian, and I'll be sending you some DVDs. Please share them all with the guys in Australia so that when Karen and I get to Australia, they think, oh, Nat Windy's a cool guy. Let me buy him a pizza. Because when I get there, I'll be penniless. I won't have any money, so you'll have to feed me. And we hope that's not going to be too far off in the future. Now we wake up this morning, of course, we were expecting maybe a fly-in day. Not a great day at all. But we are coming up on Easter, so Karen's done a little redecorating. Enzo the bunny's here. So at least we're in a little bit of a festive mood here as we come up upon Easter. And we know the Blue Jays are back. We've seen them at our feeder a couple times already. They're back, so we're gonna go see how that paint's dried up. Get that Gevalia coffee going. We got probably about two or three more days of painting trim and a little detailing, and it's starting to get exciting now.
I love to share the morning coffee with these guys.
And we've had this drying overnight, of course, and the next thing I want to do, I'm going to wait to paint the white, the little white stripe in there, because even though it's not a great fly-in day, the wind is howling along out there and it looks like it may rain, I would like to get the red painted. It would just save me from having to paint in the shop. Get a look at how these edges all came out. So far, so good. And I've got to lay out the red stripe on the wing and a red stripe on the body, which have to be dead accurate. I can't be, even though I've made patterns, that is something, if that stripe along the fuselage is a little bit off, really gonna look lousy. Now, except for the white stripe here, I can back mask, I just reversed this, back mask the red, white, and blue, and this will get painted the red that the back of the airplane is gonna get painted. Now what'll happen if I paint that white now, then I really have to let this sit, and I want to paint all the red at the same time, out of the same gun, with the same weather conditions, so that I don't get one color darker or lighter than the others. And before I backmask any of this stuff, although this paint, there's really almost no edge on there at all, it's still, it's always better to break it. Hit it with a credit card. I don't ever sand it. Sanding and trying to break that edge with sandpaper is a real high risk thing. That can bite you. That is the tiniest little bit of overspray that got down here, and a good way to get rid of that is with a little bit of Sikkens M600. If there's any overspray anywhere, usually the Sikkens will take it right off. But again, I don't want to do any sanding at all. I don't want to put any scratches in this paint. Now, it's always, you know, if you have an easy paint job, this one here is relatively easy. But if you have something more complex, obviously the back masking gets more complex. Now this is where I really try to catch the edge exactly right on the money here. And if I can, get in the corners real nice, where I back cut the corner just a little bit on a little bit of an angle. That always seems to help give nice corners. So where this comes into a corner, it doesn't just end at 90 degrees, it gets back cut, just like a piece of molding, just a little bit. And when we get to the next part of this, going to be laying out the wing and the fuselage, it'll be a lot more complex than this. So, of course, I always want to start with something relatively simple. This edge will get sealed with clear. Now, the only thing left here is the mandatory sealing of the edge. And so far, we've had, the edges on this are
the red and blue that we already have on here really are nice, so not going to change a thing. Just like to get it right up in the corner, just like with a striping brush. You don't have to go out more than a 1/64 of an inch. Although it doesn't really matter to paint. Dope usually melts the coat underneath it very quickly. And this way, if you do have a little bad spot in the tape, you get a much crisper, nicer line without having to use ultra high stick tape. And anybody that's ever pulled up the paint during doing a finish knows that is not an enjoyable moment in the world of modeling. And of course, I'm a little disappointed because I know everybody was, they were even out on a website yesterday. Everybody was going to meet at the field at 7 o'clock today. It was supposed to be a nice day, but it just didn't work out. But there's always tomorrow. Actually, it's working in my favor because if I was out there, I would be spinning my wheels right now. I really want to get some paint drying before I consider doing anything else. Because what happens is when you get to this part of the job, you get to this the last lap on a race or whatever, you really want to, I want to get the plane done. I want to see it in real life. I want to start buffing it and putting a clear on and making up all the little parts, gas tanks, landing gear, things like that. That part's ready. Once that dries up, that'll be ready.
Now, one of the things I have to really remember, part of this stripe, and I'll go back and see just how much of it's going to go onto the cowling, but I'll probably wind up, and in fact, it's probably something I should do right now, is take the tape off, put the cowling on so I can get the tape to line right up here, because there will be a little piece of this that's going to be that red, that spinner, where the spinner joins the red stripe. Now I want to be real careful dealing with this fuselage because I don't want to get any dings in this, any paint pulled up, anything right now. What I really would like to have is get that red stripe laid out. We need to get all the back masking off before we can lay that out, of course. And many times what it would happen, and I have a good recollection remembering it, is I'd get to this point, let's rip off that tinfoil, let's rip this off, rip that off. And you wind up doing some damage or putting a ding in it or ripping some paint up or putting a fingernail into it. I'm trying like heck not to have that happen. We probably have less than 1 gram of that red filler on this, filling up little mistakes. And I'd like to keep it that way. And of course the main thing is, and this is the key thing, getting this green tape pulled back. And of course you could use the green or the tan tape is pretty similar. I've interchanged them over the years. But always pulling it straight back, and if in doubt, or as soon as you see you might, even one chance in a million, pull up some paint, heat the tape. A la the little tip we got from John Brodak, and that tip has absolutely served us well over the years. Now this paint is bonded pretty well, but you never know when you're doing multiple colors over colors and tape over tape. And even that edge here where they're joining, that's pretty good. Not that I'm prejudiced or anything. Get the card out. You want to get it from several angles and edges. And you can see what it takes off. It takes off all that little roughness to the edge.
That is no overspray on this, but if there is any at all, or some gets back onto here, just a slight hint of M600 on a paper towel. I want to try to make a real good, I'm not sure what I'm trying to define here, because the wing is in a different position. It's going to force us to, well, what's going to happen, the wing is going to go through the stripe is what's going to happen when this is laid out. But I have a pattern and I know how far from the back I want this to be, so I guess there's really no skipping this. I just have to get the pattern out. Boy, the cowling fit real nice. I was real impressed with that. Every once in a while, you do catch a break. That's always nice when you catch a break. Now on a scale plane, the wing is thinner and lower, so I'm not gonna be able to do that. But I can get it going right through the exhaust. So actually the exhausts are coming out right and in the red. And when I made the pattern up, I kind of allowed for that, but I didn't. I wanted to think about it overnight before I laid this out in tape. And there's going to be some space between. See, I want to leave some space between the cockpit and the stripe, and hopefully get the exhaust to go right through. They don't go through the center. They go through on the high end of it. So these are just little details. As I lay this out and as I work with the pattern, I may be able to move the pattern or change the pattern or whatever to try to get this as close as, well, as close as practical, considering, you know, what the limitations on this are. Yeah, the exhausts are coming out on, no, there's red on top of the exhaust and on the bottom, both. Anyway, I'm going to see when I'll be satisfied when I see how this is going to look when it's totally laid out and it's ready to backmask. But having these pictures from Rich Woolbridge, very, very helpful. Now, it's going to be real helpful having that pattern, but that pattern is only a starting point. And that curve, see, two things have to happen. That curve is going to change a little bit. I've got to view it right from the front, and it's going to go around a valve cover here. Up here, it's going to be like a Coke bottle. So this is definitely going to be something that's going to take a few minutes extra to lay out. And then the final test is just to stand back and see how it looks in real life. Because I could adjust it up, adjust it down. But I've got the things that it's going to leave a little space between the cockpit, and that the stripe will go basically right through the roundel, almost on center, or maybe right on center. Now it looks like we got the criteria were to get the stripe going right through the roundel and to get the bottom lip. That looks like we got it. I want this stripe to be exactly 90 degrees. That looks good. Now I can get rid of also can get rid of now I'm trying to get this that it's very similar to the bombers, the B-25, so it has that look that I'm very familiar with as it's flying in a pattern, that red tail. I've always liked the way that looked. And of course it looks a little bit or a lot like, depending on your point of view, the Tuskegee Airmen paint job. However, Tuskegee Airmen, of course, did not have Spitfires. Okay, so that's at the back. We got the stripe. We got the right amount. We have really lucked out on this because this is almost going to look scale, except for the fact that the wing goes up into the stripe, which is, I don't think it's going to spoil the illusion at all. I think it's going to look pretty good. And it's where it comes up on the nose, I just got to marry the other side up. It's really going to carry right up into the nose. Just when that spinner is painted red, that's really going to look nice. I think it's going to look nice. Hey, but who am I to say? I'll see if Joe Adamusco likes it, then I'll know I've got something. And here's one of the things is, as you look at the side view and twist this over, it follows the contour of the cowl, which is kind of like a free lunch thing. It doesn't go up or down, but of course there's no substitute, even with the pattern, just for double checking all of the measurements. Just to make sure we're not making something that's asymmetrical. That's going to have a nice look when you're looking at the engine. That stripe is going to kind of follow around. And yet from the side, it has that chiseled look. See, because the Spitfire is all curves, all the trim is straight lines. So it accents everything. And that's what I really like about this paint job. Now, it's a little tricky figuring this out because this is going to be red. We've got a backmask, the roundel, backmask this. Gets a little tricky, and I want to spray this with the cowling in place, so there'll be no variation in the color at all. And I have foolishly fallen for that trick already of trying to paint two things that match up, and then they don't exactly match. Now, I thought about putting the tail on even and doing it all at once, but you know what? That just gets a little too impractical, so... Maybe I ought to, I'm not sure I should eat, yeah. You know what, it's more complex to do it this way, but I think the result is up in the nose, you're going to see it. And I think that stripe in maneuvers is really going to accent it. I've always liked paint jobs where there's a big, broad, bold stripe going right down the body. And you know, it took me long enough to decide that this was the paint job I wanted to do. I feel like one of these bachelors that can't figure out who he wants to marry, but I think I got the right girl now. This is kind of a straightforward backmasking. Actually, it should be pretty easy. But then everything that should be easy could be, would be, should be. Doesn't always work out that way. Anyway, as many years as we've used tinfoil and used the Walpray method, we've had, I think, the best of possible luck. Anyway, once you pick up the basic backmasking technique with the tinfoil, I think it goes pretty quick, pretty realistically. And I remember backmasking with magazines and paper and newspaper and getting all these black smudges all over the plane. A mess. So again, thank you, Walt Prey. Now, I'm just... See, what I'm trying to do, I have to go around the fillet here, so this is going to require a little bit of thought how I want to do this. Maybe I just want to back mask that separately as a separate entity. In fact, I think that's what I will do. Now, whenever I'm going to do giant amounts of tape right on paint, good idea to just rub it up on my shirt. In this case, I want to make a little angle here. And of course, the idea is to minimize any chance that there's going to be overspray. Even though we can correct it, it's always a lot better if we don't have to.
Let's see if we do it. We're going to be spraying this way. That will probably do it. That's going to be a defining corner right in by the fillet area. Now we can do that piece. And we can go right over the blue, which will be handy. I always really have liked paint jobs where that big defining stripe tradition had that. Actually, some of Midgley's planes that the blue and yellow one had that stripe. Always thought that added something. And I always liked having those red tails. I always thought that was pretty cool. That Tuskegee Airmen kind of thing going on back there. I need to make a little piece here. I gotta black out that roundel. And as crappy as the day is, it's definitely good enough for painting this. If I can get this red painted today, yes. You know, we're gonna be real careful. See, while I'm sealing this up early, so this has a little time to dry in between. I want to get a good seal on all the tape edges for sure. And we've got it. I guess a lot more scale than I thought. Well, you wouldn't be able to do the old Spitfires this scale because of where the wing is and the fuselage and the sheer size of the fuselage. So that having this wider, bigger, shorter nose fuselage with the bigger engine is contributing to the scale factor, I guess. Now this silver is absolutely beautiful. It's Bobby Brookin's B25 silver. And of course you can get this right from Brodeck if you really want to make one of these sparkly paint jobs or have this sparkly color somewhere on your model. It's B25 silver. Maybe we should call it Spitfire silver. Anyway, I'm going to finish this up, put this away, get the wing mast off, and hope the weather holds so I can get all of the red sprayed today. Boy, that would really be a treat. Now the last piece to lay out the stripe is a red stripe that goes on a wing. We've got a pattern for that also. And I'm being really, really patient about getting these things laid out correctly because there isn't that much trim on the plane, but what's on there really had better be right. And it's better be that these two line up. If they're off just a little bit, see, that's the problem. Sometimes you're better off when you have a real busy, crazy paint job because you don't see errors. When it's a simple, especially when it's straight stripes that pretty much stay the same width, it jumps right out at you when they're wrong. Just like roundels do. When you have a roundel where one circle is concentric or eccentric. I thought I was eccentric. Anyway, here I've got, I just want to show this. Here I've got some overspray down here. Let me show this. Now this is a little bit of blue overspray, some Sickens M600. And it's going to take a little bit of rubbing, and I don't want to
if I don't have to, I don't want to run Gorham's on this. But as a last resort, the M600 will usually get it off unless it's really heavy. Now, if it isn't, then it's coming off. So it's just a matter of time now. We're actually just grinding it off. Now, if all else fails, because there's no way, at least no way I know, that you can guarantee you'll never get overspray. The one thing not to do is sandpaper. Okay, so we see we've got, that's a pretty, and you can see what happened. It wasn't sealed over there. Take a little bit of our old friend Gorham's. And I don't want to go any further than once I have it off. I don't want to start buffing the paint out here. Okay, once I have that off, now I can just use a little bit of M600 at the very end here. And it's off.
That pattern we made really came in handy, because getting this stripe that they're both parallel and level is going to be a big part of this, getting this paint job to look right. We used to
say our love. That pattern is really helping us get this exactly parallel. But just to make sure that I'm not wrong, what I'm going to do is run a straight edge down both front and back, because when that's straight downwind, that I'm going to see that, because with the dihedral, I'm going to see it either on the top or the bottom. On the bottom, I'm going to see it. I don't want to see. No, I'll see it when it's right side up, because the V will be this way, and I want to see. I don't want to see something skewed off one way or the other. All right, everything's back masked off. Everything's sealed with a coat of clear. I got all the little boxes, gear doors in place so that I'll get an accurate paint line there. I'm trying to figure out which way the wind is blowing here, but it's not, I'm not looking out. Okay, this means they're going to measure for our porch. I guess I'll get to finish this later. Okay, but you can see this is very similar to the, we got a pretty good match to the picture. I got one fisheye up here that may be a problem. Yeah, we'll see. One little fisheye up there for some reason. I guess I didn't clean the part that well. Now we're just going to take a little break here with Eli Manning, who's going to measure our porch up for us. So we finally had our appointment with the architect, and it's time to paint. Time to finish this red. Oh, the birds are chirping. The sun is out. Yes, we now have official architect on the job designing us a porch. At least this color does cover pretty well. Really shouldn't say anything. That is a nice color.
We are looking at it this day. Not often that it's my lucky day, but it is lucky. What am I laughing about? And I went over to the computer and checked the color match. It is almost perfect. Now, we purposely didn't mask off the canopy because I want to do that in just a little bit different way. And I might want to use the airbrush. I don't know yet. And until I know, I want to have all those choices available. And that red stripe that goes right through the valve covers. I think that worked out just about perfect. Blowing. I want to move the camera. See what happens when the wind is blowing? All little dots get on the camera lens. It's a nuisance. Now the wind is blowing the opposite way. Just when you notice it's time to get the wing out and the wind is blowing. What does that tell you? Windy, you think it's your lucky day, but maybe it's not your lucky day. Anyway, we really like this architect. Larry Cork is his name. And we showed him the Spitfire bedroom. He was convinced. He said, "Those planes don't fly. You gotta be kidding me. They don't fly." I can't wait to see him in a week or so. I gave him the DVD of Brodax. Boy, this is nice paint. And because we're in the sun, I can see any thin spot, any spot that needs just a little more. I don't think we're going to have any here. We're in great shape. A really good match to the red. And when we get some photos and we can hold this up next to the photo, I'm not sure the screen on the computer gives an accurate color match. I'm not sure. But I want to try to do something a little detailed. A little more detail than just painting the cockpit red, but I'm not sure in my mind how that's going to work out yet. Anyway, this worked out great. See, we can tell which way the wind is blowing here. This wind is moving momentarily. Now I turn around, and it really isn't my friend here when it doesn't face into the sun.
It's always better if it just face into the sun. It would be so much easier. This might get a little interesting here. Not too bad. Really handy having that handle on the fuselage when you go to paint it. Well, that's for sure. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought they really did a really excellent job of coming up with this paint scheme for the real Spitz. And it really, every time I look at those pictures, it really complements the look of the plane. And you really can't make a Spitfire with like stars and stripes and everything. There goes the wind. Oh man. How do they do this to me? The wind's gotta be wrong. There goes the wind. Don't you do that.
I can't believe it. Anyway, you really see the ribs jumping off of that wing now.
It looks like one coat is all that's going to need.
Trying to look at it with the sun just to see if there's any spot I missed. And it certainly is going to accent the dihedral. Because that bar is always going to be a V. It's not going to be a straight line like on a straight liner. Well, this is going to have to dry overnight, and oh, I like it. Hard to describe the feeling at this point of a build.
Yeah, we'll come back to this tomorrow. Let it dry overnight.
Well, this is very significant. It's raining and drizzling and foggy and everything out there. Good thing we got all that painting done yesterday. Let's see how it's drying up. Now, I had my list made up. I've got some of the things crossed off. But we had a funny thing happen last night. By the way, you can see from this angle, I think that red stripe is really going to show up the dihedral from certain angles and views, but this you can't make this up. Karen and I are out shopping. Last night, it's already dark, and she says, what color are you painting the plane? And I said, oh, well, it's going to have da 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 and a red tail. And then I realized I never sprayed the tail yesterday, so I got down. Last night, and almost dark, it was just about dark, sprayed the stab and elevators. It was too dark to even shoot video, but today I'll get all the tape pulled up off of this. This looks like it's drying up nicely. And then we have one little thing. I got to paint a little white stripe on here. And again, I laid this whole paint job out in my little notebook. And actually, from this point on, I could start inking the tail. the tail is ready to ink. That's one thing if we're waiting for paint to dry. I need to do the red around the cockpit, and I wanted to try a couple little different techniques. I need to move the tape. It's going to be pretty labor intensive to do that. And I need to decide whether I'm going to put that yellow bar on the front of the wing that the Spitfires typically have, but not all of them, of course. And this one doesn't. But I just thought it's something I could use if this does. It looks like it needs a little more trim.
Virtually all of the war Spitfires have this yellow band and the red tape, which I didn't realize in the very beginning what that was, is they used the equivalent of red duct tape to go over the gun ports. And as soon as they shot the guns, they'd just blow right through the tape.
That was like the equivalent of red duct tape. Little things when you do a semi-scale project, research it out. I gotta paint that little white bar next. So rather than belabor this and just waiting for the coffee to brew up now. And it's really, that I keep saying it over and over again, it is an exciting time of year to be a modeler. It's like we're already in the playoffs and already headed to the finals here. The Spitfire finals. Now I always try to get a little look at how this paint has dried up. I think that's gonna be fine. And we have got, I can kind of tell just by looking, we have got an absolute minimum amount of paint on here. If we were to take Gorham's and just rub this once or twice, we'd be through. So that's one of the things I'm really looking to, obviously, to have on this. Now, it's that little white bar, and I want to pull this tape off real carefully. Real slow and carefully, because it's been sitting up there overnight. I wanted to see the contrast between the Insignia red and the red that we're using. It's a much brighter red. It's going to contrast real nice. May even put an ink line around there. But it's this little bar that I have to paint white to get this up. It's on my list as the next step. Now it's these edges, and I'm real careful at this point in time. I'll get the credit card out, card all these edges off, because the smoother those edges are, the less clear you need to bury them and make them go away. When you have big, high, thick edges, you wind up putting on way more clear than necessary. And obviously on a semi-scale plane, even more critical, because you don't have that cushion you have, like on a Testarossa, say, where you've saved weight by not having a lot of scale detailing, or a cockpit or whatever. But so far it has been our lucky day. Which probably means later today the roof's gonna cave in on us or something. But I'm real careful. I never count my chickens till all the tape is off the plane. There's always the chance you can pick up a spot, because you always have that tendency, which is especially my hands from working with the lathe and working with the carbon fiber resins and stuff. I've always got goop on my hands. That I always have these little spots where the paint doesn't really want to stick. One of them happens to be right there. But what I'll do is I'll card this all down and wipe this all with M600. But you can see the contrast in it. I think that's going to be pretty cool. But it may need an ink line just to set it off just a little bit more. Yeah, we've lucked out in the fact that we've got real nice edges to deal with here. I won't have to put a whole lot of extra clear around those edges to bury them. The M600 hopefully will get off any of the tape residue for this last step. We'll be ready to backmask that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use Rich's airbrush. I want to set his airbrush up because we're going to be using that on. He's got an Awata, and his is in a lot better, not worn out like mine is. And we'll get it set up with the white.
clean out. Even today, I don't even care about the rain. I don't have to paint outside to do this little amount of airbrushing. Such a good technique. Once you use this technique, it's hard to imagine anybody would want to use some other technique. And I remember when Walt Prey first shared this with us, I remember thinking, oh man, easy. Works like a gem. Yeah, it was funny, not forgetting to paint the tail. What color is the tail going to be, Wendy? I don't know. I just have a feeling that's one of the things that makes what we all seem to enjoy doing as much fun as it is. And it's no different with the trains, with anything. I can remember going over to Arnie's train layout, and a couple of times we'd be working on something. I'd say, well, how are you going to do that? Did you forget to do that? The simplest thing. Where's the wire gonna come from or something? Yeah. Anyway, I'm gonna get that airbrush ready. Seal around this with the clear. And this'll be really be, I think, the only white. And then I'll have to start back masking those other things. But because it's a rainy day, even doing a little bit like this inside in the back room, no problem.
The old tinfoil technique, I just think, and what it is the more complex a paint job is, the more you really appreciate that system, and that really does work well. Now this is Rich's airbrush. You might remember at the end of last year, he was very having problems using it. He couldn't figure out how to get it to work. Well, this is going to solve two problems, because when he's ready to use it, it'll be set up. And we did get this set up. I see he did a nice job cleaning it, too. Double action. When you press this down, air comes out. It releases air. And as you move this back, you can see what happens in the trigger. It releases material. Now, this is one of the nicest ones I've used. And we only need the little bottle today. We don't even need the big bottle. Rich, you're an okay guy. He even cleaned a bottle. He's way ahead of me. Anyway, we're going to set this up with the hose. Usually I like to run about 20 pounds, 20 PSI. Mix up the paint, decant the white. We'll be ready to use this in 5-10 minutes. Now, I just wanted to show why I'm using Rich's airbrush. Actually, what happened here, you see how this piece is loose? I broke this. There's a spring in here. Now, you still can use it, but it wasn't working. In fact, the last time I used it, and this did the whole train layout. Imagine how many tracks, buildings. This has sprayed gallons of stuff. Not only Brodak dope, but other stuff. So, what I do, I just keep that for my spare, and I'm going to use Rich's for doing this, well, this project, and maybe we'll break down and buy a new airbrush here. No, I just wanted to mention, I always hear a lot of comments, what a sloppy paint area you have. Oh my God, everything's got drippy droolies and but there's only one thing that's important about this, is marking the bottles, the jars, the cans, marking what's in each one. What's where it came from. I like to sometimes mark the date. In this case, I don't need the date. I know the year I built the plane. But a lot of people spend a lot of time cleaning things that don't need to be cleaned. And then the one thing that they need to know what color paint that is. Now, just as an example, you know, and I always tell people I love old tools. Look at this vise. Look at this drill press. There's something about working in a shop where all the tools are, look at all the, even a buffer, look at everything is worn and rounded off and dirty and rusty. I love it. But this is the environment that planes get built in. Because if I spent a lot of time polishing things, I don't know. Maybe I would. Maybe I'm just lazy.
See, these are the kind of tools I like to use. I love a tool like this. I don't know why. It's like a little idiosyncrasy of mine. I ground this down for some job, pulling something apart, and never, never, ever wipe it off. Because, boy, that takes the flavor of the... Well, even Karen criticizes me for this. She says, why'd you spend the day and clean all your tools? Because then there'd be one less day I could spend building. Truth. Now, maybe you like shiny tools, but unfortunately, this is what I have to deal with. But boy, they do make some planes.
Now, there's a reason I mention about all this with the old tools and old stuff. Because Karen and I have made a decision that probably, and it's probably going to be after this flying season, we are going to gut the cellar. And it's Karen's idea how she wants to do this. She wants to paint all the walls white, paint the floor light gray with those speckles like we painted the benches. She says, I've lived like a pig long enough. I gotta start upgrading my shop. So maybe she's right too. But I doubt if it's gonna change the quality of the planes. But it's true, I really do like, I can't tell you, I really do. We really do now Les, and this is funny, Les just hired an architect. Well, we just hired an architect yesterday too, to design him a really professional shop with professional benches and everything. Well, I don't think we're gonna go to that length, but it would be nice to actually just put all the production things on hold and clean this whole place up. It really is, but it's a comfortable place to work. I kinda like working down here. I don't know what that is about them. Like a comfortable cook in a kitchen. Now, I meant to put this on the tape, and I just wanted to show this. Let me get a, I don't know, something. I can, anyway. Any old can. When you mix up the paint the first time, if you do a little test, just spray something. It doesn't matter what you paint. Just spray, and you look at the pattern, and if you see out at the end of the pattern a lot of little white dots going off into oblivion, you know the pressure might be high and the material too thick. When you have the pressure and everything just right, what happens at the end of an airbrush stroke, it just fades out just perfectly. Like when we start to do the shading on this plane, we're going to really use that to our advantage. Obviously the inking, the shading. We got weeks of detailing this plane left, but this is going to be our new buddy. We're going to use Rich's airbrush. We're going to wear it out on him, and we give it back to him. It's, in fact, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to clean mine up. Not even clean it up, just give it back to him the way it is and see if he even knows it's a different one.
And it's true. The reason I say that is because later on in this video, well, maybe not this one or the next one, whenever it's appropriate time, we're going to be doing a lot of airbrush work. And having a good quality airbrush instead of an old worn out one is obviously to your advantage. Now, one of the things I wanted to mention is I still have the red in the gun. I still have the blue in the other gun. I still have this color in another gun. So if I need to touch this up along the way, I've got all, I don't even have to, I don't think, oh, nobody will see that. I got the paint's already in a gun and I can go touch it up. And that's the advantage of having a lot of guns that are all set and ready to go. You don't have that big decision to make that, it would take 10 minutes to do that or something. But I don't know why. Even as a kid, I was always impressed by workshops where they looked all mean and nasty and everything, and yet the work that came out of them was beautiful. And I guess from the years of working with my uncle, who was an iron worker, and boy, talk about a rusty tools, holy mackerel.
But boy, some of the stuff he, some of the little handcrafted stuff he did was pretty special. Well, I'm just, the next step on this is to carefully pull off all the tin foil and back masking. This should come off without any incident at all. Famous last words, huh? Because I want to look at what I want to do to the cockpit here, and I want to, obviously, I want to pull the masking off the wing, too. Now, as I'm pulling the last of the little eighth-inch tape off and carding this off, well, it really does. This has the look of at least what's up on a computer screen until I can see this and look at it right next to a hard copy. That really has the look. That has really exceeded my wildest expectations. And I needed to have that gap between, see, I needed to know when this tape was in here, how much of a gap was going to be between the canopy. And I also was looking at some other ideas of maybe running some real thin 16th inch tape around here to make a what amounts to be little detail edges. Not sure about that yet. I got to think about that. But this part of it has really, really exceeded my expectations, especially where this goes through here and when the exhausts are going to show through there. We'll talk about something that has exceeded my wildest expectation here. And now that I've seen this, actually, in real life like this, I keep wondering why it took me so long to make the decision to go with silver and red when it was always one of the choices. And I guess when I got the original inspiration, but I never made the commitment, when Pete Klepsik sent that original video that had this model with a couple of minutes of it landing, the silver and red variation. And I don't know if that was what did it for me or to get all these edges cleaned up. And I gotta pull that. Well, the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pull up masking tape off the wing because I don't like to leave masking tape on any longer than necessary. Overnight is just perfect. And then I want to carefully pull all this masking tape off the cockpit area. Once I get this off the cockpit area, then I got to decide, or I want to decide exactly how I want to back mask this, but I'm going to move it out onto the glass just a little bit so that I don't have a big giant paint buildup edge here. See, if I leave this on till the end of the clear, what happens, there'll be a notch, an edge, or whatever here. If I move that tape back out onto the glass, just half the thickness of a pencil line, it blends that edge in. So when this gets cleared and you rub your hand over it, you can't feel any of the paint edges at all.
See, what I wanted to see is on the real, on the full-scale plane, how that red accents, it actually accents the dihedral. And on the thicker wing, it really sits right up on the high point of the wing, too. And we got the red right, I think, in the right spot relative to the spinner, so the exhausts are going right through it. Here you can see from one angle what that red canopy outline looks like. Now our tail is red, of course, but we have the red, white, and blue with the thin white. Here's what I wanted to really look at. You really have the whole cockpit outlift. See, this is a war cockpit, the bulletproof glass. We don't have the bulletproof glass, so that's going to be different. But I think we got that stripe just about as close as you could ever expect. Now this one doesn't have the yellow bands on the wing, so may have to rethink that over the course of the day. And I know John Pothier today is working on that nose art. We may even see a prelude to it. See how small that nose art is? We even could model that little scoop up there if we wanted to. Maybe you could put something like that to hide the tank vents. To think about that. Now see this, the red is only around the cockpit area. It's not around the back window, but I'm going to change that. I want the red around the back window too. I think that'll just dress it up a little bit. And that's the good news about not doing one of these as a scale model.
I'm looking for other little things that may or may not be of some value to at this point in time. Now here's one thing, the walkway, it's really almost impossible for us to get that on there because we don't have that fillet. We can't do that in a scale way. And I really need to look at this from the other side and see if these, I don't think they have a walkway on both sides. But even if they don't, I want to put a walkway so it has that symmetrical look. Again, that's the beauty of not doing a scale model. And now in this picture, it looks like he has the canopy area painted, but if this were a scale model, we'd only be painting just the part, the forward glass, and the part that goes around the cockpit, the Malcolm Hood area. You know, this one doesn't have a black walkway. Maybe it's, well, this is the bubble version. Something to think about. But again, we don't have to make it scale. We have a lot of flexibility here. I'm looking at these little scoops on the side of the cockpit. And this one apparently has some kind of a black racing stripe right down the middle of the fuselage. I don't care for that at all. We'll just omit that. So that's about my best picture of how they painted up the cockpit on this. But we're gonna improvise on this a little bit. The couple of things that I can see here, I thought maybe they left a little silver stripe around there somewhere. They didn't. Well, we can be pretty free and easy with this. But before I start working on that, I want to pull all it. I got all the tinfoil on the wing there. Can't believe I forgot to paint the tail. Unbelievable. This is great. I'm trying to make a video for for a friend. I'm trying to find a part on this video. This is at Middlesex, and I see today. This is one of the days we were flying a B-25, and Bob Zambelli was out with his four strokes. But there's a couple of B-25 flights on here. I forgot I had on video. Some cool flying. Anyway, what's good about that? It makes when you're doing a laborious thing like carding off all the areas or carding off all the paint, just makes the time go quickly. And a whole key with pulling all this back masking off. Just nice and slow. And always the best tip of all, if there's any chance that you're gonna pull up paint, just heat everything with a hairdryer and it should come right up. I'm trying to look at it from several angles just to see how this looks, and really, I think it really captures the look.
Now, one of the things I got to decide here, or make a decision, I want to see how if I want to lay out those wing walks, and whether I want to try to lay them out in a scale fashion. It doesn't look like that's going to happen, though. Looks like we're going to have to improvise a little bit. Now, I'm looking at this, and I'm looking at the pictures, and I'm trying to decide on... Where's the blackboard? I made some decisions up here. This was too thin, and the doubly amount was too thick. So I want to decide on a width, and then I'll make a paper pattern up. It looks like... I want it to be the same. Roughly, I'm going to cut up a paper pattern here, an inch and a half. Now, it's always easier to take this and make it a little bit thicker than you think it should be, and then trim it down. Again, the basic rules of paper dolls 101. But I can also see what this is going to look like. This will be black. This will help me get the alignment. I want it to be parallel to the flap, to the line where that's going to separate too. And the paper dolls will help me get it even and symmetrical at the same time. And I need to go halfway around the wing, halfway around the flap, and right up to the red. Now, what this will allow me to do is do a complete mirror image off to the other side. Now, I can pull this apart and back mask it. I'm going to have to paint this flap right down, right into the hinge line, but not down into the other side, and break this right across the back. I think, see, I'm looking at it, and the fact that this cants out just a little bit looks... It keeps with the fillet line. We're picking up that fillet line in the walkway. And even though this side of the walkway is not scale, I'd rather have it that it looks symmetrical. Now, once I get this back masked, I'll be ready to spray to black. That part will be black. See, this is just one example of why I like to leave the paint in the guns, because I've got a spot on the bottom I have to touch up, and I already have the silver in the gun. I don't even have to replace the silver, so that really works out well for me. But I really have to seal the edges of this up. I'll put the black in the airbrush, just touch up the silver while I'm in the same spray mode. And there's another tip, never put any paint. If you have a gun, I call it a clear gun. It should have clear and never have any other paint in it, any other color. Well, that's a real nice luxury. And that will serve you well. Now, it was important that these line up, obviously, so I needed to do it both at the same time. Get all the tape lined up. That's what I love about doing a semi-scale plane. I guess I like it even more than doing a scale plane. Is when you want to improvise a little, nothing to stop you. As Joe Adamusco so correctly says, he calls them fantasy Spitfires. You really have a free hand to pick
pick things that you like, that you want to model, and when you run across something that doesn't look right, improvise it.
Now, needless to say, it's still pouring out there. What a write-off. Anyway, this is another little trick I have. See, where I put the tape on this? Because what happens is, normally an artist would be using this, and he'd have one hand on this. And sometimes this can get loose or slip, and in a case where you're holding another part, you can't conveniently grab it, I guess is the right word. But anyway. We have really had our share of rainy days during this project. This is going to be the rainy Spitfire. Rain, rain, go away. Actually, one of the advantages of spraying in here like this that I don't really factor into the account is I don't have to add any retarder to this mix, which I really don't want to do it if I don't have to. Especially that paint now that's going to go around the canopy. Now, I don't have any retarder in that red, so I'm lucky. But if I had some retarder in it, this would be a time to mix a new batch. I don't want any retarder getting down onto the raw canopy itself. And especially when you put the clear on that first coat, or you want that to be a dry coat. Anyway, Richard's airbrush is working beautifully. That's really working nice. Notice what I'm always trying to do is spray 90 degrees to the tape, not on an angle where I'm tending to blow the paint up under the tape. Now sooner or later Karen's going to realize I'm painting down here and she's going to be annoyed, but we have such a good marriage, she'll learn to live with it. Or I'll be dead the next time you tune in a Wendy video, they'll be, oh, Wendy died. She got poisoned. Actually. She understands the importance of getting this plane ready for the upcoming season. I never really did a head count on this, but I've had a new plane, and I can go back. Let's go back to the 80s. My God, it's about 30 years. I've had a new plane every year, at least one. Every one of those years, except for one, when I refinished the plane. So, I don't know. There might be some kind of record, like I could get the Fidel Castro Free Cigar Award or something. But I don't really think of it that way, because I just think of it, not everybody gets to build a new plane 30 years in a row, that's for sure. Some people skip more than 1 year, too. And on that year, they don't refinish anything, so I don't know. I'll be waiting to see if Fidel Castro names me as the next emperor of Cuba or something. Now, the way we've evolved the way we paint the stripes around the cockpit and paint on the inside and all the little details that go along with this, but the biggest thing is to get the paint on the outside that you don't have a ridge.
Or even in a case of like the Red Baron, a very simple canopy, I still don't want to rub my hand over it and feel the paint edges any more than I want to feel the paint edges on the paintwork itself. And to bury that in clear, if you don't have a big step there, it's a lot easier.
Now I remember, this was one of the planes. I always keep a picture of this in my shop to remind me. See the cockpit on this? And I had 1,000 coats of clear on the cockpit before I could bury the edges, and it was awful. It just bothered me every time I flew the plane and wiped it off.
Same thing with the F-16. I had to put 1,000 coats of clear. It never dawned on me what was happening. And this, of course, goes back to 83, 84. I never realized I was building up, and in this case, it's white. And that paint edge was 1/16 of an inch thickened, and I tried to bury it in clear. Not a good choice. You know, later on, when it evolved into the Spitfires and the Typhoon and all of those planes, well, we found a couple of tricks that work real well, and this is one of them. This is probably, of all of the little tips and tricks you can pick up off the video, this, if you want a nice cockpit, a realistic cockpit, this is one that works every time.
Now, step one on this, if you look at what's happened, and we've, from sanding these edges and sanding all around here, we've really broken down the edge of this tape. But where this paint is and where the tape starts, there's going to be a step, what amounts to be a step. And I want to very, very carefully, now this, I really need to do this in ultra slow motion, because number one, I don't want to pull on the canopy and create a crack. I don't want to press on the canopy any more than I have to. The canopy is a delicate area. But on the other hand, I don't want to have, and if my luck holds out today, I won't pull up any of the tape, any of the paint along the edges, although that could happen. Some of the things that really help, get a brand new blade with a razor point that you can get in there and pick those edges up. That always seems to help. And then pulling the tape back exactly 90 degrees. And if we see we're having issues, we'll get out the hairdryer. Now, the blue tape usually pulls back very nice. And let's hope it's my lucky day. Every time I pull tape, I always want to know if it's my lucky day or not. Well, we're going to find out. But this is just one of the times, and this is going to be something that's going to consume a lot of time. I don't need to put hours and hours of this on a video, but getting these pieces of tape off and then moving them out onto the glass, that just the tiniest amount, thickness of a pencil line. And what that does, it mutes where that paint buildup is on that tape edge. And I can see already that tape edge is thicker than I thought it would be. But for sure, we want it as thin as possible, because what that'll mean is we can use less coats of clear to bury the edge. The thinner that line is, the less coats we're going to need to bury that tape edge. And backmasking this, I've found, and I found this to be the, this is one of the jobs, as Karen so correctly says, you don't start this job 10 minutes before supper, because backmasking this cockpit is going to take a decent amount of time. I want every edge to be perfect. Then I want to seal every edge with that clear. I don't want to take any chance, because it's such all of the work that's inside the cockpit. If you have a big sloppy paint line here, well, kind of defeats the purpose of it. Now you can look inside and see we've got the whole inside of the cockpit stuffed with paper towels now, so that spray dust and, well, whatever dust is in the shop right now from sanding tune pipes and everything else. I don't want any of that getting up into the cockpit area. Even though we can get in there and clean it, it's always better if you don't have to clean it. That's for sure. Oh, these rainy days. Boy, and luckily I got this red painted. It was nice out. If I was waiting to paint this red today, I could not paint this much inside the house without having a problem. That would really be a problem. So, and the alternatives for me are, I have several choices of people I can go to their garages, including Rich Jacobone, and
use their facilities, but oh, is it ever a pain moving everything, and then it's raining and the stuff's falling on. And Rich has a friend that actually has a body shop with a spray booth, and he, Jimmy the body man, he's offered to let us paint there many times, and I said, oh man, I don't want to get addicted to having every time I want to paint that I've got to go over there, and I don't know. Although probably at some point in time, if we were really running behind or falling behind for whatever reason, and we really needed to spray a coat of especially clear, it probably would pay for us to use Jimmy's facility. But I just think of, I have this idea in my mind that I always like to be self-contained. I like to have everything I need right at my disposal in the shop. And I really don't know why I'm like that. Paranoia, probably. Anyway, this is going to take time, and I don't want to bore everybody to death. But I wanted to make the point that not just to grab the tape and rip it off, or really, really carefully, and I'll card all the edges off, wipe it with M600, and then carefully backmask it just a tiny bit out onto the glass. Now, here's one trick that from time to time, and right now is a good time to show it, because we're coming up on a point in time. Now, this paint is relatively thick in spots, so before I actually try to pull the green tape off on the side of the paint that's extremely thick, I just kiss this with the razor. Put a new blade in every two or three cuts too. I'm not cutting into this, I'm just scoring it. And what that's going to do, I'm going to go around the whole part. It's going to hopefully give me a little bit cleaner of an edge. Now, when I move this tape back, I don't want to pull up a big glump of tape, a big glump of paint. And I go around the whole perimeter. And I'm going to do this pretty much every time that... I don't want to... Again, I'm trying to get a nice crisp cut in where paint ends. Now, because I've sanded this tape about 20 times already, what happens is tape is very thin in spots. So I really have to be real careful. Slow, because I want to pull up the paint. Now see, the tape is ripping. It's not pulling up all the paint there exactly the way I want. I'll just stop for right now. This is why I didn't want to do this at the same time that I was painting this red. There's a little bit of a problem when you try to do that. I would not be able to see how this would look, and I was just figuring, I'm gonna get too cute. And I've been trying on this model especially not to get too cute. Now see, I can roll this back, and I can see the tape is, because I've got it so thin, it's not leaving a good edge here. I can just get the razor under there. And what would happen if I didn't score this? This would be a very rough edge. Now, even though we're not going to use the edge, it's not going to be a final paint edge. I just want to keep this nice and neat every step of the way. There we go. Nope. It's a little difficult getting in there from time to time. Oop, there we go. If you can see up close how that peels right back. And see, it's not always as smooth as I'd like. But it's still better than if I didn't score it at all. Now sometimes, that even as careful as you are, that edge is so thick that it wants to peel up. Now since we're going to be putting paint on it, I'm holding the razor as close as I can to parallel and just trimming the edge. Get like a hair off of it. Now here, there's a little spot up here. Before I start the back masking. I guess I could just feel with my hand where it's bad, right here. I almost need to hold the blade just flat. And the rest of this, it won't really matter because we're going to paint there. That's going to get painted. But if you don't do this step and you waited till the a model was finished to take that tape off, that paint would be so thick it would be a very negative thing. Get right in the corners here. Just shave that. Oh, what comes off of there is just a hair. But it's what makes the difference of a really crisp edge. There's a little bit right in there, in fact. Now the next thing, before I go any further, is get a brand new paper towel and a little bit of M600 just to get all the fingerprints off of there so that our back masking sticks as good as we can get it. Now because I've been handling this area and because there's a lot of little rough edges here, I'm going to do this. Then I'm going to card this carefully. Yeah, I can see the little hairs that are coming off of there? Seems like it's a lot of work to do for just for cockpit detail, but when it's done right and you show people, it just stops them in their tracks when it's done right. It changes the whole, to me, the whole look of a semi-scale plane. Not so important, of course, on a Cardinal or something, but when you look at it and you go, oh, how did he do that? Well, it's really not that hard, but it is definitely time-consuming. And effort consuming. But then everything we do is that, you know, a Stradivarius violin is harder to make than a fiberglass guitar. And what adds to the illusion here, as I do this for about the 10th time, what adds to the illusion is when you look inside, this is going to be red and inside it's green, or this green zinc chromate color. All right, we're about ready to back mask, I think. Although anytime I like to be able to feel it. Yep, still one up there. Now this is where it really gets tricky, is I want to leave the equivalent of about half of a pencil line. But the most important thing I want to have is crisp corners. So I try to trim the corners back on about a 10 degree angle if I possibly can. Now it would be pointless to just go right up to the paint, and I want to be real close, but not right on it. Yeah, Now the same thing, I'm going to try to get in that corner and just come back at a 10 degree angle. Well, let me show what I'm talking about.
I don't know if the macro lens is capturing that, but I'm just leaving, and that's about a half of a pencil line. Now, many times, if I were doing this, and this was already not silver, but I was going to paint the opaque paint on it, for whatever reason, and I built up a lot of paint, I may have to do this several times to avoid that edge. Now, what happens is, even though that edge will blend in the final paint, it'll fill with clear, and it'll kind of go away. But getting the corners really crisp, see, this one is already cut back a little bit. And that is really the hardest part of the whole thing, is getting the corners, especially in these, where the little reinforcements are on a scale model.
And get some idea of just, that's in reality about a half a pencil line that I've moved that up.
Now I need to do the outline of the outside and then backmask the whole fuselage with tin foil, or else I guess I could backmask half of the fuselage and use the airbrush one or the other just to so I don't have to backmask everything again. Oh, we'll see. That canopy I think is going to be one of the focal points of the plane. I'm going to see how this looks, some 16th tape to make like a canopy, because obviously this is the part that slides back and forth. And if I don't like the way it looks silver, I'll just have to ink it in, because I'm going to have to put some of the little, there's a little track that this rides on as it goes back on a scale plane.
And I don't know how much of that we're going to be able to show, but we'll certainly give it a shot.
See, this is the canopy we're trying to replicate without the bulletproof glass and with that slider back there. I'm not sure we're going to be able to do that in real scale or very scale, but we certainly will try to get that track in there too with ink.
Now what I decided to do too, and I thought this might be something worthwhile, I'll backmask this all with tin foil, of course, seal all these edges up with clear, let it dry for a while, and then I'll put the red paint in the airbrush, because it'll give me a real nice parting line. It'll be thinner paint. Now, even though this is good, the airbrush will make it thinner, and since we're not going to ever put tape on top of it, it won't even matter if we lose a little bit of the bond. It won't be a big deal one way or another. It'll just make it, well, I hope those paint edges, because I want to really, when I'm done, just run my hand right over that. That's one of my goals. Yeah, I did decide to put the paint in the airbrush just because I thought I'd get a thinner paint line on here. You'll find out. Now we can't paint outdoors today anyway. The idea, of course,
idea, as with everything, is to just get the paint edges neat. Sloppy paint edges, you know, frustrates me when I get them. And usually it's because the paint is too thick almost every time, because I've just put too much paint on without moving the tape around the canopy especially. Anyway, this is probably all we're going to be able to do today. Realistically, I think we got a lot of good use out of what normally just would have been a throwaway day. Hang all this stuff up to dry and celebrate.
Well, it'll be interesting to see when we come down here next time we get to work on this. Pull this tape off. And we didn't forget to paint anything today. Lucky us. Now tonight, all that paint is drying. I wanted to try something really, really unique. Now follow through with this. This is the first time we've ever tried to do this. What we're gonna try to do is actually physically take a ride on the train. Now, it sounds easy until you try to do it. Well, what I did is, and I'll show you, my friend Arnie has a camera that goes on the train, and that's pretty neat, but it doesn't give a good signal, and it only records in black and white. So I said, Arnie, we gotta do something about this. So what I did is I took my secondary camera, the camera I used to shoot flights, and put it on the front of the train. So you can see what this railroad looks like from the train itself. And we're gonna see if we can shoot some footage. So there's Wendy's video camera. It's actually our tripod camera. See, now once we get done with this, we're going to see if we got any interesting video or how it looks. And then we'll look at how this looks. I'm interested in seeing if this is going to work at all.
Thank you. So this is the end of our test. Karen just said, supper's ready. Okay, we're gonna go down and take a look at this footage. This looks like might be some fun.
Keep in mind, that was the first time we ever tried this. And if you look real close, you can see something that's, really showed up well here. All inside these tunnels is lined. And as the train goes now, we see we're inside the tunnel. You can see the whole inside of the tunnel is brick lined. I thought that was pretty cool. I thought it was cool when I did it, but hey, hope you enjoyed that little visit to the railroad from the train. I thought that was pretty neat today.
Now, one of the things that'll be pretty neat, Arnie Haber wants to come over with some of his trains and do the same thing. Now, he has that cheesy camera, that black and white camera, but when I showed him this footage, oh, he just flipped out. He just couldn't believe how good. And all you need is an ordinary DVD camera like I have. Anyway, it gives you some idea of, and we've seen footage that people have put on control line airplanes and taken pictures, but I think this is just cool. Now, I could just picture John Cafaro's father. You could put the camera, he doesn't even have tunnels. You can put it right on top of the engine or just put it on a flat car or a gondola. Just adds one little dimension to the things that we enjoy about our, look at that big face in the back, ugly. Woo, like Godzilla. Still a lot of fun.
So here's the next step, John. You get your dad a nice DVD camera, put it on a gondola, shut the lights off. See, the bigger trains, it'd be no problem at all. Anyway, hey, I thought that was a great little experiment, and we're going to do more of that in the future. And we learned one valuable lesson. The diesel engine sound that you hear, we got to get rid of that diesel engine sound. Just shut the sound off, and that would be the end of that. Then you can hear the steam engines even more. Anyway, that was an experiment. That was the first time we ever did that. And Arnie's going to throw his black and white camera right out the window. Anyway, back to the workshop. Back to the Spitfire project.
And one of the next steps for us is we have to make a decision. I want to lay it out and see if I like it. That the yellow wing leading edge band. And that was one of the things I wanted to include on here. But I wasn't sure if I wanted to include it because it isn't on the silver prototype. But I just thought it would be one extra little thing I could put on here as long as I'm in the paint detailing mode, I guess is the right word.
Now, all of the war Spitfires, of course, have the yellow. All of the ones that are camo. And they always have the gun placements are, it's blocked off with this red tape that they used to just shoot through the tape. I guess that made the wing more aerodynamic there up until the point that they shot the gun.
We included that in on all of the original Spitfires. And I'm not sure if I'm going to want to include that, but one of the things I thought it would do would be accent the dihedral. Because those two little tips would be kind of up. Well, we'll see when I lay it out in tape.
And as always, if in doubt, just lay it out in tape before you make any kind of commitment.
Now, everything's dried up. We've got all the masking, the back masking off, and I can get to see how some of this is going to look. The little opening silver bands look like they worked out well. These two colors really look, I think they look spectacular together. And I know one thing for sure, when we're flying at any field where there's trees on a background, the red and the silver, they'll just jump right out at you. That will not be like the problem Rich Jacobone has with the Stuka, that it blends into the trees.
And one thing we learned with Rich's Stuka, the original Stuka he made, not this one, he didn't have the yellow on the rudder and he didn't have the cowl painted yellow. And when we go to fly at some of the fields where we fly here, where you're on a dark background, the plane would just disappear in a wing over pullout. It'd be very hard to even see it. Even these little yellow, the little tabs on the end, this of course is the bent wing Stuka, and this one shows up much better. So I want to take advantage of all the things I've learned, and I want to see if, again, I'm going to have time, I haven't had my coffee yet, to decide if I want to have those little yellow bands, even though it's not prototypical, if I can include them in on this,
It may just add one little dimension of visibility to the plane too. And that again is the great part about doing semi-scale. I actually think semi-scale is harder to do than scale. Because scale, you measure it, or it's either on or off, and you're done. But when it's semi-scale, you have to decide, how big should I make it? Should I make it, make that like on Rich's cockpit? Should I make it bigger than scale, smaller than scale? Fuselage to wing relationships, stab relationships, all of these things play into it. And I mean, some people, you build a beautiful plane, and you get one part wrong, and the whole plane looks terrible. And the sport is littered with planes that were almost, they just missed by a very little bit. And then I think some of them, Rich's Stuka is one of them, that they hit it right on the head. We look forward this spring, I should say very soon, we're going to be making Rich up a bigger gas tank. At the end of last year, he needed a bigger gas tank. When we make our gas tank, we'll make him a bigger one. But semi-scale is alive and well in New Jersey. And so are those train. I love that train footage. And the other thing is, while I'm working here, I cleaned off the padded table, of course. I can be playing that footage over and over and over, just like I'm over a train ride on the KW. All right, let's get to work. Get that coffee brewing. Now, you might think that Dancing with the Stars, we'd never have to endure another Dancing with the Stars. Not so. It's Dancing with the Stars year. What is this, the second year or the third year? Oh. Unbelievable. Look at what I got to look at here. Now, Karen, see, we TiVo this the night before, so it's actually daylight outside, and she's watching Dancing with the Stars during the day. This way we don't have to watch the commercials. Look at this. Fast forward through all the nonsense. Oh, put those windy videos on. I'm going down to work on a plane, Karen. I can't take this anymore. I can't take that girl. She's so... Who's this?
This is Adam Carolla, who was with Jimmy Kimmel.
I'm going to work on a Spitfire. Yeah. See you later, baby.
Bye.
There you go. She's watching Dancing with the Stars. I'm watching Dancing with Todd Lee. What's wrong with this picture? What is wrong with this picture? This is the dancing we want to do. Let's go get that Spitfire made up. Todd. I know, Todd, I know you're probably dancing with your wife, but I'm too old.
And I really thought, foolish me, I really thought last year when that ended, they'd never have a rerun. Ugh, now I got to endure that for another 6 months.
Now what I did, I wiped everything off with M600 because I've been basically working on other projects where I got my hands good and greasy this morning. Just when you thought it was safe, they restart Dancing with the Stars. Now what I want to do, I want to lay this out in tape, and this looks pretty easy until you go to do it. Because you've got to figure, this better be right on the center line, and it better not deviate. Well, out here it's pretty easy to find the center line. So let's just see if we could run a line. That didn't work. Okay, so if we have that as the center line, now I gotta make sure I'm right on the money, because if that varies even just a little bit, boy, is this gonna look sick. Okay, now I'm thinking, even this out even a little bit more. Yeah, I really wasn't sure. I'm still not sure if I really want to have this. But what I was thinking is it would be a nice way of accenting as this comes into the wind. And I always liked the way it looked on the war versions. And it goes about half of the span, so that's pretty easy to figure where that'll end. And it goes way past the end. So now, what I can do is lay it out with, well, let me see if I got quarter. I don't have any quarter inch tape here today, so I'll just have to use two pieces of eighth inch.
And what I'm thinking, and I guess I'm thinking it right, two pieces of eighth inch tape would just be a good start to see how I like the way this looks. Now the reason this is more difficult than you think it is because this shape is coming to a point and you don't want to have it look like it's, you want it to look the same width here as here. You don't want it to look like it's two different widths. So if I started with, and let me just think about this. Let's make it too wide to begin with. Just make it too wide to begin with, and then, and since we're not trying to copy some scale feature, I'm not going to give that any thought either. Now what I have to do, I have to look at this from several angles to see if this is what I want. See, I want to look at this from several angles. So what I think I'll do, I'll just make it one piece of tape wider and then get a look at it again. Now we're up to, this actually will wind up being a 5/8 stripe. But I want to see the same amount as I go across the curve. I don't want to see this get wider and wider and wider out at the tip. And it sounds like a little insignificant thing until you start laying this out and you realize this is one of those things that if you don't get it right, it's not going to really look like how I want it to look. Now, what I'll do, and because I wish, see what I wish I could do, I wish I could look at this with a paper pattern, but it's not going to happen because you can't hold it in place like this and you can't center it. You really have to get this kind of a stripe, even if it's this kind of a stripe in a traditional paint job, you like that, it's got to really follow that. If it starts to come up or starts to go down or starts to get wider, any scenario like that, it's going to really detract from the overall appearance. Now I finally got, and it's a 5/8 stripe, 5 layers of tape. And I shouldn't say I'm really happy with this, but I'm thinking it looks very much like the bars when I look over at the scale pictures, and it looks like I've pretty well got it on center. Now the other part of this is going to be, and this is going to be the hard part, this piece of tape has to get laid out without any issues at all. And I was just trying to think of some cute way to do this. There really isn't any. And then I'm going to have to try to figure out the exact length that'll make this look the most complimenting. When you're dealing with a curve, boy oh boy, everything just gets to be a little more difficult. I really do love that train footage. I thought that was pretty cool. And Arnie just went off the chart. He went and spent $200 or something for that black and white camera, and it sends the signal through the rails. It's really, I'm not sure what it is. Okay, now we know, once I pull out that tape, then that's just gonna let me look at what it would look like if it was a little bit thicker. Yeah, I'm not sure, maybe it should be thicker. You know what? This is how these things evolve. We're going to see how it looks one stripe. That would make it just a little bit thicker. But see, I can't really make a pattern with this. And this is one of those things that I really want to be right. What am I talking about? I want the whole plane to be right. Dances with Spitfires. And I had even thought, well, if I don't like this, I could do a black leading edge or something. And oh geez, no, I don't want to do that. And what convinced me, I guess what put me over the edge was when I was up in a train room the other day looking at the Seafire and the Spitfire with that little yellow on a leading edge. I said, yeah, I remember that. I remember even putting it on video. I thought that was one of the nice little features of that. So now we're, let's see, we're 7/8 total width. Now we got to see if we got this. Because I can always back mask it thinner. Yeah, that looks like it's going to be better that way. And it doesn't go all the way out to the tip. It goes probably about to the end of the trim, plus a little bit. So what I'm going to do is flip this over now. Oh yeah, I like that a lot better. Definitely. Now I just got to flip it and do the other side. And I just wanted to mention something too that I found important. I used to think that when people did artwork, any kind of artwork, you just took the brush and painted a picture. Well, if you've ever watched a real artist, they go back and forth constantly. I call it fine-tuning, but that's not the right word. This, believe it or not, this is one of the more difficult things to lay out and get right. And it's one of the things that if it's wrong, it's going to look horrible. And if it's right, it's going to add a dimension of Spitfireism to it. A dimension of dancing with Spitfires. Now when I add the last piece of tape, I think we're going to have it. And then the only thing left is the length, and that'll be definable. But these artsy things where you just lay something out, or in John Pothier's case, he doctors up a photo for us and make this darker, make it lighter, make it bigger, thicker. There really is a talent to that. I'm not sure there's not a talent to this. And it's definitely, I am going to get some cool railroad footage in the future because I've got a couple of other ideas of how I can mount that camera so you'd actually look like you're actually in the train. And I'm wondering why I didn't think of that years ago. See, if I'm so smart, how come I didn't invent that little camera, sell thousands of them, be totally wealthy? You know, and I could, I'd have a real Spitfire and a Ferrari. See, and as I pull these individual stripes out now, I can thicken or make this stripe thinner or thicker. And I had thought thinner was going to be better, but as I laid it out, now what I want to do, I want to look exactly from the top, because I want to see, to compensate for this curve, I want to see from the top and from the front that the stripe looks symmetrical. And I want it to go completely. See, from the top view, I want to see the same amount. I don't want it to taper off or taper in. And it's, see, with the metallic paint, it's making this line look different. When that's opaque, when it's a color that's non-metallic, it's not going to show the same. So I'm trying to envision that in my mind, that that's how I want to have it. Oh, it took me a long time to figure out that I want to have this on the third rib from the roundel. And I went and looked at a lot of the pictures of this. Also, out here, I thought, oh, cute, I'll line this up with this. No, it looks wrong. It's got to be a 90 degree to this. It's this corner that's 90 degree that makes it look just a little bit more appropriate to what the Spitfires are. Now, while I'm doing this, because in the next couple days we're going to get ready to start inking this, I've already started watching and reviewing some of the ink line videos. And several of them are real good, including the original Spitfire one and the Seafire one and the Typhoon. Excellent. Actually, the B-25 and the A-26 are good too. But I can start getting the idea in my mind of how I want to ink this, because it's going to be extremely complex, the ink work that I want to do and the shading. That's one of the highlight features. But now it's a question of going out to this wingtip, making all exactly the same measurements, then coming back here, putting a coat of clear on everything, and then putting the tin foil on it. And I can do that part of it off camera because it's all redundant to this. Once I get to this point, what's real nice, and actually anytime you're at this point,
and you've got one side and you just have to replicate it, then it really starts to get, I think the second side just goes in a third the time, because you're not figuring things out, you're just copying. And that, by the way, is one of the advantages of looking at older videos before you do work. Because you can remember, oh yeah, I made that mistake. Oh yeah, I made that. Oh, I had that problem. I had that problem. And you don't tend to make it over and over again. Especially, like, I'll just give you an example. Painting these roundels. I remember painting the roundels on the first Spitfire and not having a clue how I was going to do it. And it really made me crazy. And if you don't lay these out in a way that makes it easy to do, you could wind up with hours and hours of extra back masking and tape edges and everything. It can be very frustrating. The videos always, they always save you time. All right, time to back mask this, load up the gun. Maybe I'll use the airbrush on this.
Diversity, there's maybe something said. I really shouldn't. This odd diversity of misery and gin. I'm blue in some strange way. I'm glad.
Now, what I decided to do, and the golden rule that I've used, is if I'm not going to ever put tape over something, and this will be the end of the tape, no tape will go over the yellow, in theory anyway, unless we make some radical change, what's going to happen is the airbrush will give us a nicer edge, at the trade-off will be just a little less adhesion. But we'll have plenty of adhesion if we're not going to put tape over it. And so, and I've been having good luck with Rich's airbrush, by the way. I've really liked using that. Awata is really the top level one. If you're going to buy one, I'd recommend that as being choice one. And Brodak does sell them, and I think you can get them right from Will Nomura too, but I'm not sure. Anyway, once this seals up, we'll be ready. I'm going to load up the yellow into the gun and airbrush the yellow onto this. Now, in the course of doing this, I've been watching some of the Spitfire inking videos just to get some, I don't know, get me up to speed on some of the tricks and tips, and maybe give me even some ideas on using the ink pens. That's a whole nother, well, that's going to be on the next tape. We'll start the inking and the shading on the next tape. But we want to finish this. We want to finish up the painting of the trim on this tape. And we're 15 minutes from the end of it right now. This is the color that we used on the Spit and on the Seafire. And it's a really bright yellow. This is one of the colors Dave Midgley had custom mixed for us. And thank you, Dave. It was a very good match to the picture, by the way. A yellow can really tend to be a pain in the neck to cover. But when you're going over B25 silver, almost every color covers very well. Again, we're not going to put any tape over this. That's the exciting.
Well, that is really a nice, bright yellow. There's no doubt about that. Now, I want to let that sit for a minute, and then I want to do the bottom side. Really difficult to paint in this back room, but in the case of the weather that we have out there now, definitely not painting outside, especially with an airbrush. When you try to paint when the wind is really howling with an airbrush, it just blows everything away. Making sure that I get a good wet coat on here, that I don't get just some fuzzy dry coat that as soon as I put clear on it, I'm going to see the silver through. I want to have one at least nice. This'll be a very bright yellow, and as it comes around in a circle, I'm sure this will be one of the visible things. And anytime I doubt that, what I do is I go get, and it's very easy to do, go get the Walker flyoff video for one of the Spitfires, and boy, even through a tripod camera, you can see this yellow. So one of the nice little defining features that we have for this model. And again, it's that semi-scale thing. If it was scale, this would all be cut and dry, but semi-scale, we like that mix and match thing.
Okay, one more step, and of course that's got to dry overnight. The next part that I've got on my list here, I want to start laying out some of the ink, and I've been watching some of the other videos, of course, but what's going to happen here, we have a little bit of room at the end of this tape, and what I wanted to do is I wanted to include some of the back masking and some of the taping things that we've had on similar videos, just to give you some idea of what's on some of the other tapes that you may have missed. And obviously we like to share this stuff. It's still good information. And this is from our previous 21 years of shooting video. I think some of this information you'll find very good. It's all good backmasking information on various things that would be of value. And because we can make these tapes oval length, I think it'll come in very handy, and it's free. How I want to do the blend from this, from the wing panel. Let me get the flaps in neutral. Obviously we have to get in there. I may go back and forth on this four or five times before I come up with the parting line that I really want. Now I still have to get, if
bottom and yellow babies. I'm gonna let the house gas out a little bit here.
Now, to give you a little idea, this was roughly 1 ounce of paint went on here to do this much with that extra pigment. Roughly 1 ounce. And I think this is even pushing it. I think I could have done this with less. There's some spots around a scoop I did 2 or 3 coats because that's where the paint is gonna wear thin. Anyway, I really tried to put it on super thin. I know we have a lot of whistles and bells on this plane, and I really am trying to keep the weight in the low 60s, and I think it'll be fine, but I really don't want to, at this point in time, just get carried away. So I'll let this dry, and then we'll get on to the first coat of camo. We don't have to do anything. Of where I'd like to have these colors change and blend. Now, I originally thought, like with a camo job, you could just invent it as you go along. Not really. Most Spitfires do have a general, like a pattern, and I've been trying to, well, at least use some of it. A little dangerous spinning with the rudder here. I actually have a drawing over there that has pretty rough, a rough outline of the camo. Again, we'll, this looks more straight. You can see how little paint it takes to actually cover. Oh my God, President Nixon calling during a camo job. Trying to get in by the hinge lines if I can. Now the real thing with this is, there's no tape on these edges, so I can kind of just feather them in. And I'm really not looking to actually copy a specific paint job, but. And when I put the dark on, of course I can change it. Now I noticed most of the spits are dark up around the canopy. I guess that's for reflective purposes. Now one thing's for sure, it's a lot easier to do this than it is to do the hard edges. If you go back to the old Spitfire tapes, masking off the, all that camo was a monumental job. This is really kind of easy. And of course you can always just add or take away. Now this will have to dry for, I don't know, an hour or so. I'm gonna go have lunch and coffee and then maybe get back to this. Maybe even get the last color on today if we're real lucky. Yes! I really do like these colors a lot better than the colors we had on the Spitfire. These are a little more contrast. Thank you.
Now I can just do my walk around. Looks like we got most of those under control. I got to remember to remove that hatch. I don't want to paint that in position. I also have to remove the tip weight box. I want to paint those items separately. The fillets are a little bit better. I think this is going to look super when the canopy's back. Anyway, you can see some of the blush here telling me that if we were going to use more of that paint, put on like coat after coat, I'd really want to put some retarder in there too. Anyway, if you do one bay at a time, it seems to go, and you just, hey, make the most of it. Hey, look at this, President Nixon calls. You believe this? Well, it looks like we got one side done anyway. Well, I'm closing in on getting ready to buff the last little bit of this in the next hour or so. Hope you're really having a great time. By the way, that gun sight, thinking of things I really like, that gun sight really does look awesome. Okay, see you tomorrow. Quit while you're ahead. Flaps went on. I guess the same as the elevators, not much different. I just want to look around, make sure I don't have anything like a fingerprint. Because when that epoxy's wet, what happens is you get it on your finger and, ooh, it's just a little bit, you touch something and whatever. So right after all the hinges are in, it's always a good idea to go around the thing with some final shine or whatever. Make sure the controls are nice and free, and boy, there's something you don't want to hear right now. It's that click, 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 those hinges clicking. Anything like that. Anyway, this really, really is starting to shape up. And I have to tell you, it's even beyond my wildest dream how nice this is shaping up. I think this is really going to be a really, really good plane, really special. And in every way, I hope it's going to be competitive. I hope we're going to be, I haven't even checked the weight. But we were an ounce or two over the Spitfire weight, and I think this will handle it just fine. So I'm going to pack it in tonight. Try to get down here early in the morning.
And once you think it's about how you like it, just seal it with some clear. Move down to the next one. And we'll let the tape dry. I don't want to get rough edges if I don't have to, even though this is going to all get outlined with ink. And now that's got to dry.
Now while that's drying, I have a little bit of time here. I wanted to take the Typhoon, since what we've done, since about the last time we've really flown a plane, we took the 91 out. Give that a rest. We want to run the 72 in here for a while. And because we haven't charged the battery in the Z-tron, or we haven't done any of the, you know, the maintenance in here, I want to pull this whole front end apart. Make sure that none of the wires are loose. Make sure we put a fresh battery in here. Test the Z-tron again. Make sure everything's ready, because we may get to fly it this weekend. We're going to try to get some flying in. Well, we hope the weather's going to stay nice. But again, it sat over the winter. And another thing, it's pretty sad. Chris Cox was here. We pulled the plane. Look how flat these tires are from sitting over the winter. So, needless to say, we'll get a new set of wheels on here. But that's just from sitting. Isn't that unbelievable? Anyway, it's always good. And a lot of people, I think one of the things they shortchange themselves on is not doing the maintenance in the beginning of every season. Now, we're coming up on the beginning of the season. It's worth spending a couple hours anyway. Clean this all up, polish it, get some wax on it. Make sure we don't have anything loose, or the tubing, replace the tubing. A little maintenance goes a long way. Every spring, I'm always amazed at how many little things. You know, you take the tubing out and you see there's spots where the tubing's been rubbing on the cowling and different things like that. In this case, I had adjusted this linkage in a kind of a haphazard way. I'm gonna correct this, see how much play is in this linkage. I want to take advantage of the fact that, you know, it's not flying season yet. I can take care of that. Do some maintenance on the nose here. And then the last thing of the day, maybe go outside and get a test run on a motor, make sure there's no junk in the tank or anything that is going to ruin our first day out at the field. I'm not sure if you can see how that glows. Boy, that's got some depth to it anyway. And I would suggest, from looking at what we're doing now, just go over ordinary Brodak silver with a nice wet coat of this. Put a coat of clear on that. Looks like Kaiser Wilhelm's hat here, doesn't it? Watching too many wings. I'm not sure you can see the flakes and the pearl or whatever's in here. Just to give you an idea of what the difference is, you can't get them both at the same time. This one really reflects the light back. If you want to see what this looks like after it has clear on, just go find a Mercedes dealership or an Audi dealership. Look at what that looks like.
So far so good on pulling up the tape. We don't have a lot of back masking left to do. See, if you do the plane and you do the whole plane silver and then paint the red, imagine how much backmasking you have to do. You have to backmask the plane a tremendous amount more than if you do the trim and then just backmask the trim. So I've always tried to do that. Also, the advantage of that is you have less weight, because you have less, there's no part of the plane that has double paint or triple paint. So that's a little bit of an advantage anyway. I'm just trying to see how this silver paint is going to peel as far as the edge goes. Perfect. Again, if it starts to get a little sticky, that was such a great trick of John Brodak. Just warm it with a hairdryer.
By the way, I don't think you're going to be able to see how just how shiny this silver is in real life until we actually get it buffed out. But even right now, with no clear on it, it's, I don't know, let's see. It's a shine at a level I've never experienced before. All right, as soon as he gets here, pick this up and I can get back to work.
Every time I use the laser, one of the things I do is go back and check. Check the table. The table's on zero. This table I check on a pretty on a regular basis. Now, when that's put up on a wing, that's your double check. Zero should be zero. And so you can go, and I'm guessing, I'm just going to guess that one of these amounts is a degree, one of those notches. And since I don't know exactly how much I want, a degree, a half a degree. Now, that new wire, I want that new wire, and I've basically got a half inch to add to it. I'm assuming these are the wheels I'm going to use, I'm not going to vary that. But the wheels can then be the fine tuning, so let me bend up that new nose wheel a half inch longer, then do all the checking over again off camera, and that'll be it.
This was just a pipe dream. Boy, I wish I knew if those nacelles were going to make lift right now. It's difficult to explain the feeling of excitement when you get to this point where it's all in one piece and you can kind of just look at it on the floor before you go to bed. Here's something to dream about. Now, it's fun just sitting here looking at this thing from a lot of different angles. Anyway, this has been just so exciting. I just can't even explain it. I really think Dave has captured the essence of the B25. Just captured that overall look.
Quiet, join a dating club. He's making me crazy. But you can see how nice that's coming up. We got one more nacelle to do and then we'll flip it over. I'm gonna see just how tough you really are. And I mean, this is really the test. I would say, I got the whole bottom buffed out already, but I'm going well into the day, well into the point where I really should have taken a break because I'm excited about seeing the whole part buffed out. But there is a part, there is a point at which, and I'm already at that point, I still have one panel to do, where the old arm, it just won't take it anymore. Even a bird is looking at me and thinking I'm crazy, but I really figure if I get the push on this and we don't get the phone ringing too many times, I may get this done today. Boy, what a milestone that would be to be able to go to bed tonight knowing this buffing is at least done this much. The other thing, I got a call from Dave Downey. They've got P6 drawings in the mail waiting to come to me, so we'll get them and get a copy of them down to Ron Merrill, try to get him stoked. And boy, Dave has been coming up with, they're already working on it. He's already probably got it programmed into the Boeing computer.
Okay, so honest and truly now, how long did that take to do the whole thing? Truth.
I got here.
You were here at 7-ish? 7:30?
Maybe quarter of, but we didn't get to work until, say, 7:15, because we're looking at pieces.
Less than 2 hours, anyway.
Oh, clearly.
Hour and a quarter.
An hour and three quarters.
Okay, I could believe an hour and a quarter or something like that. All right, next time we see this, it's going to be all lettered up. It's going to be a new guy ready to go. And you can decide now. There's a secret cockpit job. We don't know if Tom likes it yet or not. We're going to see if he... When he brings it back, we'll see if he likes it or not. Or if he scribbled over my name and said, Windy Who. We'll find out real soon.
Ooh.
All right. And probably get two planes in here, and that changes everything. Because obviously we don't want to go playing bumper cars with this thing. This is our Sunday-only Ducati. I guess that's a good way to look at it. Now, what I'm thinking, we ought to get some foam anywhere where it can hit a rudder and just...
We should have a protector.
A bed pad.
A sock that goes on the wing up to about here.
Yeah, a bed pad.
And then just somehow lock it in so that rudder won't hit the side.
Some kind of a bed pad would be real. I don't know if Karen's got... Well, maybe we'll take the one off the bed. I guess that'll work. Well, you probably can tell I'm still not happy with the way these synchronize up. I'm just going to have to work on it tomorrow, the next time I get to work on it. And it looks like until we can get them synchronized and getting running the same here, it's pointless to even think about it. Well, we'll give another shot tomorrow.
out, and you only had eight. Very, very exciting.